Simon & Schuster Audio presents Enough, Our Fight to Keep America Safe from Gun Violence by Gabrielle Giffords and Mark Kelly. Read by Mark Kelly.
In memory of Charlotte Bacon, Daniel Barden, Rachel D'Avino, Olivia Engel, Josephine Gay, Dawn Hotsprung, Dylan Hockley, Madeline Sue, Catherine Hubbard, Chase Kowalski, Jesse Lewis, Anna Marquez Green, James Mattioli, Grace McDonald, Anne Marie Murphy, Emily Parker, Jack Pinto, Noah Posner, Caroline Previti, Jessica Ricos, Aviel Richmond, Lauren Rousseau, Mary Sherlock, Victoria Soto, Benjamin Wheeler, Allison Wyatt. Introduction. We are a reasonable people, we Americans. We share common goals, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Those words have knit us together since 1776. They spelled out who we were then. They are just as uplifting and foundational today. Our diversity has made us a bigger-hearted people, regardless of our religion or skin color or political allegiances. We are all Americans, and we come together to root for our favorite sports teams and watch fireworks on July 4th. We vote, and we pay taxes, and we send our kids to school every morning with the expectation that they'll return to us that night safe, happy, and maybe a little smarter. We have remained intact, weathering the inevitable disagreements of a strong democracy for over 200 years. Through wars and peacetime, recessions and prosperity, struggles over civil rights and equality. But Gabby and I fear the country has veered off course when it comes to one important issue, how we relate to guns, a basic freedom that both Gabby and I wholeheartedly embrace, the right to bear arms, has become radicalized. When guns get in the hands of the wrong people, as has happened all too often in recent years, they can transform even the safest places, a movie theater, a place of worship, a school, a shopping center, into combat zones. More and more over the past decades, guns have not only been used to keep the peace, but to rob us of our peace. Gabby and I came face to face with the most horrific aspects of America's gun violence problem on the morning of January 8, 2011. As Gabby was meeting with constituents in a Tucson shopping center, a young man wielding a semi-automatic handgun shot her in the head at close range. In fewer than 15 seconds, he murdered six people, including Arizona's chief federal judge and a 9-year-old girl, and wounded 16 others. For the next 2 years, the most basic life or death questions consumed our family. Would Gabby survive the bullet through her brain? Would she walk again, smile that won my heart, speak, hug her friends? Miraculously, but with great difficulty and much painful work, Gabby has prevailed over the injury to her brain. We have shared joy and frustration, wins and losses along the way. Doctors, friends, family, and Americans everywhere helped us through the hardest moments, and they remain essential to my wife's continued well-being. All along the way, Gabby's ongoing recovery has compelled us to ask larger questions that confront us as a nation. And time again, we return to the subject of guns. What can we do to protect innocent Americans from the mass shootings that have become so commonplace in the years before and after Gabby was shot in Tucson? These tragedies are forever imprinted into our national consciousness. Virginia Tech, Aurora, Newtown, the Washington Navy Yard, Fort Hood. And these are only recent examples. Mass shootings, however, mask the toll of everyday gun violence that is horrifying in its banal frequency. More than 31,000 Americans died by gunfire in 2010, over a third of these homicides. Add non-fatal wounds, and you have a national nightmare, one that makes our country stand out in the worst ways. The U.S. rate of firearm homicide for children ages 5 to 14 is 13 times higher than in any other developed nation. Our gun murder rate is about 15 to 20 times the average of countries like France, Italy, Japan, and the United Kingdom. Why does this keep happening? Why are we just sitting back and watching while more and more innocent Americans lose their lives to gun violence? Gabby and I started to wonder if perhaps reasonable people, the overwhelming majority of us after all, might be able to band together to make our country less dangerous. We began to ask ourselves, what can we do to keep guns out of the hands of people who cannot be trusted with firearms? How can we preserve the rights of law-abiding citizens to own guns for hunting and self-protection while keeping them away from criminals and the dangerously mentally ill? How can we give law enforcement the tools it needs to stop guns from being traded illegally by unscrupulous dealers, to bring criminals to justice by tracking guns used in crimes, and to make it harder for known stalkers and domestic abusers to acquire guns? After Tucson and the shootings that have followed, Gabby and I have returned to these questions again and again. She and I had dedicated our lives to public service out of love and duty. Our work is not yet done. Gabby entered politics in 2000 when she was elected to the Arizona House of Representatives. Then, at just 32, she became the youngest woman elected to the Arizona Senate. The voters of Tucson and Arizona's 8th Congressional District elected her to Congress in 2006. They re-elected her in 2008 and 2010. As Congress convened on January 6, 2011, Gabby read the First Amendment of the Constitution on the House floor. 2 days later, she was shot in the head. I joined the United States Navy and started flight school in 1986 in Pensacola. I qualified as a sharpshooter while at the U.S. Merchant Marine Academy and later as an expert marksman in the Navy. I flew 39 combat missions over Iraq and Kuwait in the first Gulf War. I went on to become a test pilot and then an astronaut, piloted 2 space shuttle missions, and commanded 2 more, and spent more than 50 days in space. After the Tucson shooting, Gabby and I kept discussing different paths of public service we might pursue. No matter where the conversation started, we found that we inevitably returned to the same subject, gun violence. Now, Gabby and I had never had any quarrel with the Second Amendment. Quote, "A well-regulated militia, being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed." Unquote. My wife and I have always believed deeply in that principle, and we see no need to infringe on that right. We are proud to be among the 34% of American households that reported owning guns in 2012. I occasionally hunt. Gabby has owned a handgun for years. She shot with her right hand before the shooting disabled her right side. These days, she's learning to shoot with her left hand. But as much as we love guns, we also believe in the rule of law. Because we care about public safety, we don't allow people to drive cars on the sidewalk, and we don't permit teenagers to buy alcohol, and we take measures to ensure that our kids aren't drinking arsenic in the school water fountain. Why then can't we agree on a few simple rules about gun ownership that honor the Second Amendment while protecting Americans from random gun violence? In the last 2 decades, anyone who's dared ask that sensible question has been muzzled by intransigent and uncompromising political interest groups, most notably the National Rifle Association. The NRA's response to any question about tightening restrictions on gun ownership is a resounding no. Though only about 1.5% of Americans are members, the NRA has the money and political might to rank among the most powerful interest groups in the nation. The NRA began as a venerable organization of gun owners, but has since diverged from its founding principles and also from its own membership. Does the average card-carrying NRA member know that the organization is actually a trade association that's more focused on corporate profits than the rights of gun owners? The NRA's stated mission is to protect and defend the Constitution. But they also make time for generating revenues of almost $228 million a year. A regular annual NRA membership costs $35. The top brass at the NRA, like its CEO, Wayne LaPierre, take home nearly $1 million a year. Instead of protecting the interests of the law-abiding gun owners who dominate their membership roles, NRA leaders...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.